وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، قال سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم: بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today's topic, inshallah, as you can see, is tuning to the reality of piety, and we will be discussing that in the light of the Ayatul Bir, the 177th ayah of the Quran, which was just recited by Ismail. But before we do that, there are some leftover points from Surah Al-Asr. We'll summarize that quickly, whatever we talked about last week, as much as we can, and then we'll talk about a couple of points that were left. So last week we all came together, same day, Friday, and we said that there is a very desperate need for all of us as a community, as a society, to reconnect with the Kitab of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, which is why we are carrying out these weekly halaqa to connect ourselves with the Kitab of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala using this syllabus that was designed by Dr. Sarah, which is Lections from the Quran. Now the entire syllabus starts with Surah Al-Asr and revolves around Surah Al-Asr. In Surah Al-Asr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights a very, very important reality that all of us were in a state of loss. And we discussed the different ideas that the surah gives us, that the height of emphasis of the statement that we are in a state of loss is as much as it can be. Not say that human mankind is in a state of loss in a more emphatic way than was said by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other thing we talked about last week was the concept of success and failure. What is success? What is worldly success? And what is success according to the Quran? Where we said that if you have these four categories, then at least you're not a failure. Even if you don't have anything worthwhile in terms of dunya. Right? But if you have these four criteria that are mentioned, then you're not a failure. And we also mentioned these are the bare minimum. These are the passing marks. These are not highly successful people who do these, but these are people who just avoid failure. Just barely avoid failure. Or becoming losers in the dunya and the akhirah. And then we discussed the fallacy that is very prevalent in our society, and that of considering iman to be sufficient for salvation on the day of judgment. And secondly, considering what we have as just saying the kalima, whenever we were young, as we consider that to be iman. And we discussed how those that idea does not even fall through and is vehemently rejected by the surah. Right? So, there's just three remaining points that, which we couldn't talk about, which were not brought up. Actually, there was a question afterwards that the idea of the concept of success and failure that was given, the world that we live in, the capitalistic society that we live in, how is it possible to enact that this concept? Now, obviously there's no easy answer that I can give in 2 minutes. For that, you would have to, inshallah, bear with us through the entire series. It's not going to be a short time, it's going to take a while. But just briefly, the worldly success is not inherently evil. Wealth is not inherently evil. Being a successful person, even in worldly terms, is not inherently evil. Dawud and Sulaiman, alayhi wasalam, were both successful people. Had a lot of their attack that nobody would ever have. And they were successful people. Dhulqarnain is also mentioned in the Quran, and he had a lot of wealth. He had all the resources imaginable in his time. And he was a successful person as well. Point is, wealth in and of itself is not inherently evil, but to have the love of wealth in your heart and to make that the top priority, putting down these other priorities, that's a problem. That's where the problem begins. If these four criteria which we spoke about are not present in our hearts, and this worldly success is coming in the way of achieving goals, like we're supposed to achieve goals, that's where the problem begins. Right. So another point that we did not really discuss or get into was that these four criteria of salvation, they're inseparable from each other. you have proper iman, that will result in proper amal salih. Righteous deeds will be a natural consequence of true iman. And if you're doing amal salih in the way it's supposed to be done, then that will result in tawasi bil haq. And once you're doing tawasi bil haq, it is inevitable that you will have to be patient, so that necessitates tawasi bil sabr. And the converse is also true. If you want to check whether or not you have iman, check whether or not these other three are present or not. In other words, if you're not having to, if you're not having to practice sabr and patience in your daily life for a long time, that means real tawasi bil haq is not present. If that's not present, that means amal salih is not proper either. And if that's not there, then that raises questions about our iman. So it works both ways. So if tawasi bil sabr is not present again in our life, we should be questioning our iman. Where does that stand? If we're not having to be patient about our iman. Because the most simple people, the simplest of people in the history of mankind, the people who spoke the most, the softest words, the softest people ever, when they opened their mouths to say the truth, they had to bear with the consequences of patience. So if they had to bear the consequences, then what does that say of people who just very sweetly get by it? Because when you challenge the norm, when you try to go against the tide will try to drag you with it. So it will demand patience. Right. So another point that I wanted to highlight is maybe it would be a beneficial practice for us to question ourselves from time to time again to whether or not these four criteria are present in our life. Like there, the Quran of Allah Ta'ala and who said, Hasibu wa balan wa hasibu. Take account of yourself before you are taken account from. So if we have some sort of a chart, maybe something like this, I don't know, and as we go through the syllabus discussing each of these separately, maybe we can improve this chart as well. Taking an account of ourselves before we are taken account of this. See where do we stand in terms of amal salih, in terms of tawasi bil haq, in terms of tawasi bil sabr, and does that qualify for us to put a check mark in front of the iman? And at the end of the week, if that doesn't really not falling through, then that's a cause for concern. We need to do something different. Right? So, as we also just, I guess this is an appropriate time to talk about the structure of the syllabus. The first, it consists of six parts. The first part is which we're doing right now. The first part is the comprehensive lessons. The most comprehensive we've already covered is Surah Al-Asr, even though we didn't go into it as much detail as we should have perhaps, but for the lack of time we couldn't. So there's three other components of this first part. One is the one we're going to talk about today, which is Ayatul Bir, and then after this there's two others. Then we'll take each of the four criteria mentioned separately and talk about those criteria from the Quran, from the Kalam of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Because really if we develop, if we understand that there is a need to develop these criteria to adapt them, to practice them in our lives, then we need to the perfect source to get them, to acquire them, and to implement them in our lives is obviously the Quran. So it will deal with these seven. And towards the end, when we've done all of that, we will summarize everything in one comprehensive surah, which is Surah Al-Hadid. Right? So, now let's begin with the topic for today, tuning into the reality of piety. Now, every human being, every single one of us, everyone on this planet, there is, we feel the need, the requirement to do something good. To do at least something good. And that is because every human being, we compose of two parts. We're just not this animal physical part that we see. There is an inner part, inner component of the human being. The human being is a composite of two things. We're not just one, we're not just made of dirt and that's it. We also have the root. We have the root from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that soul is present in every single person. And just like the physical part gets its nourishment from food and water, that immaterial, intangible, that ruh, the spirit, the khudi, that also requires sustenance. And that sustenance is provided by acts of good, by acts of piety, by acts of righteousness. Right? It's to the point where we see that the people who are classified as the most immoral people of the society, like the gates, the robbers, the murderers, the women who sell their bodies, even they have some concepts, certain ideas about piety which they with which they satisfy their biting conscience. Because this this soul, if it's not fed, then it will create problems. It will cause an unrest on the inside. And to satisfy this, to satiate this unrest, that's why everyone has some concept of piety. So you will see the infamous area in Lahore where these women do whatever they do. They also have a yearly festival in which they give a lot of food to a lot of poor people. So apparently, and from the society's eye, these are very evil, vile people. But they're satisfying their souls with some idea of piety themselves. Right? So on the whole, that was just talking about the most, in the society's eye, the most evil people. But generally in society as well, we find this to be true. So generally we can divide the world into three kinds of people. There is the religious kind of people, right? They pray, they fast, they may grow beards, they may have a cap on their head, they may wear hijab, they may wear niqab and stuff, and they go to Hajj and they do all those things. But in terms of dealing with other people or dealing in their businesses, they might be cheating other people, they might be lying, they might be involved in smuggling, they might be involved in interest-based banking, but all these kinds of things. So these so-called religious people might have these things part of their lives as well. And then you have the other category of people to which the vast majority of the educated class falls under, that's the ethical. Those are the ethical people. They think that they're doing good by being good to other people, by giving money to the orphanages, by opening up a hospital, or things like that. They think they don't have any need for praying, for fasting, for all these other kinds of ideas. They think that the point of religion is to make a person good anyways, and we're already good because we're doing good in the society. So we're okay. So everyone has certain ideas of piety with which they've satisfied themselves. Right? And then there's the third category of people, and that's the ritualistic people. These, you can subcategorize them as religious people. These are people who have a concept of the ritual aspects of religion, and they go so deep into the nitty-gritty of it. So deep into the nitty-gritty of it that that's all they see. Right? So that's the religious category of people going into that direction. Just again, we have these two kinds of people. Both of these people think they are on the right track. They think they are good people. If you want to qualify somebody as neek or sharif or good, then they have an idea in their mind from which they categorize themselves to be neek and sharif and good. Right? And for the ethical person, that's all the ethics that he practices. And for the religious person, that's all the religion that he does is religious. To the point where you will see an ethical person say, if you ask him, why don't you pray, why don't you do this, this, that, the third, you'll be like, I've seen you religious people. I've seen people with beards and they go around cheating people and they're rude to people and they lie and they do this and I've seen them do all of that. I don't want any of that. I'm already good. Right? So they have this idea. And an example of the ritualistic kind of people, something that a lot of maybe the youth trying to become Muslim experience when they're trying to practice more. So you have a typical youth, 19, 20 years of age, right? And he decides for something happens in his life or whatever, he's like, I need to start taking my religion seriously. And he goes to the masjid, right? And before going to the masjid, he calls up his girlfriend and he's like, you know what, we can't work out anymore. I don't know who's going to send him. So, bye-bye. And he throws away all the bad things that he used to do, and then he goes to the masjid, and the people he comes across, and they sit and they chat, and eventually they start saying, you're very lucky that you came to us and you don't go to mass. Those guys are misled. They are misled. You know what they do? They put their hands here with their brain. And they don't say this, and they don't do that. They are completely against the religion. And they are completely misled. You are very lucky that you came to us. And then he goes to the other person, and they're like, you're very lucky you come to us, and I'm going to those people first. Because those people, they do this, and they do that. They wear a turban of this color. They don't say this, and they don't say that. So that person's like looking from here and there, and like, basically telling differences about form. And they're classifying each other as misguided based on appearances, based on how the subtle minor differences in the way they pray. So they're doing that, and this person's looking from here to there, to here to there, and he's confused, like, I came here to connect with God. Where is all of that? Where is all of that? I'm here hearing this group, ash, that group, that group, ash, this group, word by word. So it's like, thank you very much. I think my girlfriend gave me a call. And there's a new season for How I Met Your Mother. So I'm going to go watch that. And religion can, I'll take it there. I'll take it. So the idea of proper religion, of real piety, of real goodness, of real righteousness, what is a comprehensive concept, Quranic concept of who a good person is? Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah begins by a negation of a certain idea of piety, a certain idea of righteousness. And as an example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the third category of people that we're talking about, the ritualistic people. People who have gone into the nitty-gritty of rituals so much that they've lost the spirit of the religion. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَنْ تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is not just piety. It is not true, or rather, true piety is not just. Right? True piety is not just that you turn your faces to the east or to the west. Right? So the ayah is beginning with a negation, an outright negation of an idea. Now, the example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using is something that everyone pretty much agrees with. Which direction do you turn to pray? Everyone knows when you're supposed to pray, you're supposed to face the middle. It's part of religion. You can't deny it. Which is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say that it's not at all piety to turn your face eastwards. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it's not just piety. It's not the only component of piety. Meaning there is more to piety. Right? So it's laysa birra, not laysa birru. Had it been laysa birru, it would have been this is not part of piety at all. It's laysa birra, which means this is part of piety true, but that's not all there is to it. There is more to it. There is much more. That's really interesting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses something which all of us pretty much agree on. In terms of the apparent aspects of salah, every single person who calls himself a Muslim agrees that you have to face the Qibla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using that and telling us, you know what, that's not it. That's not all. There has to be, there is something more. There is definitely something more to religion, righteousness, piety, than justice. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins with the affirmation. Just like our kalima tawheed, where it begins with la ilaha illallah, negation, and then affirmation. So first there is a negation of a limited concept of piety, and then there is an affirmation of a holistic concept of piety, of what piety really is. Right. So let's, before we talk about that, is the word for righteous piety is bir. The word comes from the root words ba, right? And the idea, there's two words that come from this root, ba and bir, right? Bir is what we are talking about, that is piety, and ba is also used in Urdu, it means land, right? Bahar wa ba, you see and land. So the idea behind which they're related words, and when they're related, it means there's something in their meaning that is related. So when you're at sea, and you're in a ship or whatever, and there is this uneasiness about the journey, right? There's always, there's these ups and downs, there's this fear of a storm, and you're not completely at ease. You're not completely at peace with yourself, right? So there's this constant fear. And when the ship rocks, and when you finally, you're on land, and your feet touch solid ground, then you relax. You feel at ease. You feel at peace with yourself. Right? So you feel more comfortable. So that's the idea behind bir as well. That when you do something righteous, when you do something pious, that gives you that peace, that serenity, that calm that comes with being on land. That's how the two are related. From a stormy sea, so a life without righteousness is a life in distressful circumstances, in stormy circumstances. Right? Right, a life with righteousness, where if you have piety in your life as the main component of your life, then that's when you're on land, that's when you're safe. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins, when he says, وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ, he starts with, مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّ. And subhanAllah, that's really strange, because when we ask someone, what is your idea of goodness, of piety? Like Maharaj Alam and Nate Kupana, right? We'll be like, person who prays, person who gives charity, person who does this, person who does that. We relate it with actions. We relate it with some sort of a practical action. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the ayah, first and foremost, without saying, before saying anything else, he says, "Man amana billahi wal yawmil akhir," the one who believes in Allah and the last day and the angels and the book and all the prophets. So that's before we talk about any action, let's get the foundation set first. Right? And before we talk about the relationship, the deep-seated relationship between Iman and Piety, let's ask two questions. Right? So these two questions have plagued the philosophical world for a very long time. Question number one, bear with me for a little bit. What are moral values? Right? What is morality? And are these moral values constant? Or do they change with changing time? Right? Moral values mean right and wrong. Where do they come from? What are they? And if we live in a different time, if we live in a different generation, if we live in the 21st century, will they be different from what they were 1500 years ago? So that's one question. The other question, the more important one, what is the driving force for piety, for a moral, for a moral value that you've set for yourself? Why should you do it anyways? For example, if you are in an exam, you don't know anything. You're going to fail that exam, you're going to repeat the year, your career is going to be destroyed, this, that, and that, right? And you have all these ideas going in your mind. And the paper of the person sitting right next to you is open before you to look from. What would stop you from not looking at it? Why would you not do it? Everything about it, you can get away with it. You can easily get away with it. Even if you look at God, mostly teachers will be very lenient to you. So you can easily get away with it. Why would you not do it? Because apparently there's all sorts of benefits. You will get through, you'll get your degree, you'll get a good job, and in that job you can cheat. Nobody's gonna, why would you not cheat? Cheating gets you more money gets you more comfort. And comfort is all we're looking for in this life in which our success revolves around money. So why would you not do that? What is the good reason for not doing that? You can say like, oh, it's gonna harm other people's interests, whatever. I'm here, this is a survival of the fittest, right? This is a battle for who the strongest is, he gets it. I'm more successful, I'm more witty, I deserve it. So why not? Why shouldn't we cheat? Why shouldn't we cheat other people for money and whatever? Why shouldn't we do that? So what is the driving force for not doing wrong and for doing right when you have to? Right. So let's kind of ask the first question. What are moral values? Where do they come from? Are they constant? Are they not? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَفْسِي وَمَا سَوَّاهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the soul and the proportion of order given to it. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَىٰ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this has placed this ability to discern from right from wrong in the soul. It is inherent within our soul to know what is right, what is wrong. You travel across continents, you go from New York, or you go to the jungles of Africa, a civilization that probably has no contact with the modern world or whatever. You go to those people, even they will know that telling a lie is wrong. Telling a lie is wrong, and being truthful is good, helping other people is good, even they know. Because it's been placed inherently in our souls. Everyone knows it. Which is why, in other places, the words used for good, for good actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says ma'ruf. Ma'ruf also used in Urdu, something that is popular, something that is well known, right? And munkar is something that is strange, something that is foreign, something that displeases you. So the idea of a good action being popular and a bad action being despised and foreign to you, that in itself tells you that these moralities, these moral values are already inherent within us, mostly, right? So moving on. Not for the driving force. Why should I do it? The reason I should do it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Amana billahi wa yawmil akhir." The person believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he believes in a creator, a sustainer, who gave him every single thing that he possesses, the master of the universe, the creator of every single thing that exists from the smallest to the biggest, the owner of every single thing, is the owner of that person himself. Every single faculty that that person possesses has been bestowed on him, has been given to him by that being. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So just knowing that idea, just that should just move us to do good, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the last verse, there's a surah Adiyat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an example of horses. Don't you look at these horses storming forward in the war? There's clouds of dust rising behind them. and they're jumping into the enemy army and the enemy group and into spears and swords and all sorts of things. They're just jumping in. They know they can die. Why are they going in? Because their master is good. Their master, all he does is gives them food. All he does is takes care of them. That's all. That's it. And he tells them, now go into the battlefield, into that spear, the horse of theirs. And then immediately after that, the Lord of Sala says, in the insanity of the man, on the other hand, mankind, on the other hand, is very, very ungrateful to its master. We, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does much more than just give us food. Give us every single thing that we have. It's just out of gratitude, if you have to jump in, like of course I have to jump in, then we should be willing to do it, right? Just out of gratitude. It's just common sense. But still, most of us, the vast majority of human beings, will not be at that level. We won't do it. That's not enough of a driving force. So there's another added belief that we have to have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His wisdom created the scheme of things that He has, the way He's designed designed life and life after death. There's the belief in akhirah. And if you don't do it, then you will have to pay for it. Every single action that you do, small or big, that will be brought before you, whether you like it or not. On the day you will say, "Man, I had a kitab la yughadiru saghiratan wa la kabeera," that what kind of book is this? It does not leave out the small or the biggest thing that I've done. Every single thing is accounted for. And when you have this in the back of your mind, when you know this, that whatever small or big action you do will be presented before you, and you will be presented before the Creator and the Master of the heavens and the earth who has the power of punishment and throwing you in hell for eternity, then yeah, you will not look at that paper, even if it's calling out to you. So that's the driving force. That's the why we should do good. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places these two fundamental creeds right in the very beginning. Usually what we will see is, when we're talking about Imaniyat, we're talking about articles of faith, we say, "Aamantu billahi wal malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi," and then we talk about the other part, right? And even in the last ayah of Surah Baqarah, that's the sequence. We talk about "Aamantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa rusulihi wa mu'minu kulluna amana billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi," right? That's the sequence. But over here, because the topic is righteousness, the topic is piety. How do we do it? Why do we do it? Which is why it's one aspect of piety. Because the strongest motivational force for you to do good is that. So the sequence has changed. So alhamdulillah, nothing in the Quran is without a reason. There's a subtle change is there for a reason. Right? Which is why you're the aspect of one. So that's the driving. That's the why we do it. And now, also another thing, well-known hadith, "Innama al-a'malu bil-niyyat." Actions are judged by intentions. Such is the importance of this hadith that Imam al-Nawawi, wherever he started his hadith collection, he starts with this hadith. Whatever you do, if you're not pushed by these two driving forces, you're not doing it for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for His reward in the akhirah, to escape His punishment in the akhirah, if there is any other reason apart from that, that's it. That deed will be rejected. That is not an act of piety, no matter how you want to classify it, no matter the whole world thing, it's very chivalrous, very honorable, very amazing. It's not going to do it. What has to be there is the iman. The reason for doing good has to be the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdullah said that intention, so important, the importance of intention is that if you're doing something huge, a huge act, you're fighting and dying for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A huge act can be made very, very insignificant. It can be worthless if it's not backed up by the proper intention. And a very, very small, insignificant act that you probably forgot and didn't even notice, you just picked up a peel of banana peel from the floor, but if it's backed up by a proper intention, by a right intention, it's made huge. It's made huge. That's what intention does. Ibn Atta'illah said that intention is the soul. Whatever externally you do, that's just the form, that's just the body. That's lifeless. The life is the intention. That's what gives it essence. That's what gives your action essence some value. So that's the importance of iman. Right. So we talked about the first two imaniyat mentioned, but there's three others. Right? Bear in mind that we talked about amanu when we spoke about surat al-qasr, right? So this is that iman opening up. We said the first four lessons are going to be comprehensive related lessons to surat al-qasr. I'm talking about pretty much the same things from a different angle. So now this iman opening up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said three other things. Malaikatihi wa kitab wa nabiji. And if you want to envelop all these three in one term, that's Prophet. Right? Because the malaika, what do? They bring revelation. What is revelation? It's in the form of the book. Right? And who gets the book? That's the Prophet. Right? So in the previous two imaniyat, we understood that why we have to be good. Over here, we're understanding how we're supposed to be good. If we're going to do whatever we're going to do, how are we going to do it? We're going to do it the way the book tells us to do it. We're going to do it through messenger. Right? Because this urge that we have to be good, that too can go out of bounds. That too can go out of its limits. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created everything in the balance. And we're supposed to maintain that balance. Right? But if in our urge to do, to be very pious, we get overzealous, then that too is imbalanced and that too is rejected. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, reminding of this fact of our iman as well. An example of that is when three people, three sahaba, came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's wives. They came to his wives and they questioned. They asked, what is the nafli about that? Right? The, apart from the obligatory, what does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam do? And the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them as it was, right? Because the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an open book. So the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, they told these three people, this is how much he sleeps, this is how much he prays at night, this is how much he fasts. So they're like, okay, but he's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's forgiven. We gotta do much, much more than that. So one of them is like, I will fast continuously, I will not take a break. The other one is like, I will stand up in prayer all night, I will not sleep. The third one is, I am going to dedicate my life to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will not marry. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard of that, he immediately called them back and he told them, I am the most fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of you. And I sleep and I pray at the same time in night. I marry and I have a number of prayers. Right? And I fast, but I break my fast as well. So when raghiba an sunnati falaysa minni. So this is my sunnah, whoever deviates from it, whoever takes another path, he will have it rejected. He has nothing to do with me. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is cutting himself off from the person who does not do it the way the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it, or the way he said it needs to be done. So no matter how zealous, how amazingly big we're becoming, but if it's misled, if it's misdirected, it's going to be rejected. What happened with the Christian monasteries, right? When the Christians took to monasticism, where it took to not marrying and being holy for their entire lives without getting married, both the nuns and the priests. The result of that would be found in the basements of those monasteries, where there was a graveyard of illegitimate children. Because you were suppressing something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a right for you to balance out, to live the way it's supposed to be lived. And if that is suppressed, then that's what's going to happen. Right. So now for the what. We spoke about the why, we spoke about the how, we're all sleeping, so we're going to take it up for the what. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the amal salih part that is opening up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, wa'adallah, after having this intention, after having this firm belief, not just lip service, but firm belief, so that it can be seen in your life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa'adallah, ala habbihi dhabil qurba wal yatama wal masakeen wa bin as-sabeel wa sa'ileen wa fir riqab wa aqam. First of all, we're going to categorize these actions that are given into three categories. First of them is human empathy and community service. Second one is ibadat. And third is interpersonal relationships. Right? So let's take each of these in turn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first of all, He speaks about empathy. He says, وَآتَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ ذَوِالْقُرْبَ. So even in spite of all your love, or your wealth, your hard-earned wealth, your willingness to give it up for the welfare of humanity, to alleviate the sufferings of other people, that's righteousness. That's piety. That's the holistic. That's the first component in the holistic concept of piety after you have a foundation of iman. That's what you got to do. When you're talking about the pillars of Islam, yes, that salah comes first after the kalima. Salah comes first. Kalima jihad, salah, zakat, sawm, ramadan, hajj, that comes, that's all there. But when you're talking about righteousness, when you're talking about a good person, and one of the abroad, then this comes first. This is the order of priority. Right? So this is in relation to the context in which we're speaking. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has emphasized spending in the way of Allah so much, where he says, "Lan tanalu al-birra hatta tunfiqu mimma tuhibbun." You cannot, you can never achieve piety unless you spend from where? From that which you love. That which you hold dear to yourself. You don't give up the things that you don't use anymore, that they're old and they're run out and they're no use for it for you, in it for you. No, no, not from that. From the thing you love the most. That's where you need to give up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of your worn out clothes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need that. He doesn't need anything, but you need it. You need to be giving up. So when you're giving to all these people, recognize that you're not doing them a favor, they're doing you a favor. Because of the two, who's benefiting more? In terms of akhirah, who's benefiting more? The one who's giving. So rather than them telling you thank you, you should tell them thank you. And you should be honored that they're giving you the opportunity to raise your rights in that. That's how our attitude, the Muslim's attitude, should be towards helping his fellow beings, towards giving them, towards giving out, sacrificing from that which you love, not over now. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Layl, he says, أَمَّا مَنْ أَعْقَالَ تَقَالَ صَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُ يَسِّرُ كُلُّ الْيُسْرَى. You want the secret of how to make the easy path easy for you? How to make Islam easy for you? First step, start giving out. Start giving out for the sake of the Prophet. That's the first. Then what the Allah says about the Prophet. But first step, reduce the love of dunya in your heart. Again, love of money, wealth, dunya is not evil. It's love is evil. So reduce the love. If dunya is not your top priority anyways, then it shouldn't be a big deal giving it out to other people, right? If that's not the top priority, if the top priority is out, then you would want to give out. SubhanAllah, we just, when we're buying something for ourselves, we don't think about it twice. We're like, yeah, okay. We don't even use it, it's just sitting there, we still bought it, when it comes to giving out in charity, think, I have to buy that, I have to do this, I have to go there and here, how am I going to do this? I'll just give you some of that. So that's what's kind of our attitude should be. We should be willing to give up for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another surah, Surah Al-Balad, a number of places in the Quran highlights this and calls it the steep slope. It's a steep slope. Apparently it looks very hard to climb. You can climb the steep slope, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. What is the steep slope? Giving out of the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right. So, and the way they've been emphasized in the so category, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ يُحْرَمْ يَرْفْقَ يُحْرَمْ يَرْفَيْ. Whoever has been deprived of rift, of softness of heart, and softness of his heart, he will give out to his fellow beings on everything. Somebody doesn't have that, he's been deprived of all goodness. He doesn't have anything. If you don't feel the pain of your brothers, if you don't want to help them out, then you've been deprived of all. Another hadith, Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمْ لَا يُرْحَمْ. If you don't have mercy, you will not have mercy then on you. If you don't have mercy on others, you will not have mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another hadith, Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الْخَلْقُ the creation is like the family of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's how much we should take care of. There, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling them messengers of Allah, is saying they're like a family of Allah. That's how you should regard. So the next time you think of saying something rude or something degrading to anyone, no matter who they might be or what they may be doing, think about it, that the family of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is associating them with himself. Right. And this long hadith on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, O son of Adam, I was ill and you did not visit me. And the slave will reply, Ya Allah, you're the visited him, you would have found me there. And you would have found that, you would have found me there. And another other part says, I was hungry, this man that said, I asked you for food and you did not eat. And this is on the day of judgment. And this lady would say, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are the creator of the heavens and the earth, you're the master of the heavens and the earth. How can I feed you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, my slave asked you for food. Had you given it to him, you would have found that food with me over here today on the day of judgment. That's the importance, and similar for Allah. That's the importance of giving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right. So the order of priority, you're going to give out, but who do you give out to? That will put by your relatives, your near of kin. وَلِيَتَامَ and then the orphans. وَالْمَسَاكِينَ and the weak. The miskeen is someone who is weak and dependent, can't work for themselves. Right? They can't do it, they can't work for themselves, so they need help. وَبْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَالْحَافِ right? Then وَالسَّابِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ and then those who ask you, and then وَفِي الرِّقَابِ are the slaves who those who next are caught, they can be slaves, or they can be people who are under so much debt, no matter what they do, they can't pay it off. So these people are the people deserving. But first up, there's amazing wisdom to have on this this order of prayer, how you're supposed to give and who you're supposed to give. And the first four, these are people you have to seek out. These aren't people who are going to come wrap themselves around you and say, give me. No. You're going to have to find out. So what we call the bad motion. You're going to have to seek them out. Because again, you need them more than they need you. You need them much more than they need you. And that's our responsibility to help these people out. First of all, families. And the family is the hardest to help. So you get one member of the family, the other member like, why do you give them? Right? Because there's more animosity between family. You give a random person, there's not going to be that much trouble. It's harder with them, right? So that's the order of priority. Then comes the ibadah. Then comes the aqam salah wa ibadah. And subhanAllah, this is necessary concept of consequences of iman, of true iman, and they then necessitate. Meaning, if iman results in ibadah, if you have proper iman, that's when you're going to go pray. And ibadah increases iman. Right? SubhanAllah, it fits so beautifully in this ayah. Just one ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving us the whole formula pretty much of ayah. What it means to be good. Because without getting into the details of the actual place of salah and what it means and what it does, just in context of what we're talking about today. What salah does is it reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it reminds you of the yawmillah. So the driving force towards piety, towards goodness, you're getting five times a day, you're getting a reminder of that. Five times a reminder, so you refresh it in your mind so you can go back into the dunya and do it with full force again. So the driving force is being renewed. You're getting pumped up. Go out and do it again. Right? So that's kind of such wisdom in the placement of these actions in this ayah. Right? And what zakat does is that it paves the way for sadaqah. It tells you that you can still survive even if you give out a little from your you know, it paves it. It like the Rasulullah used to say, it's the cork of the bottle. If it's open, now let the wine flow. Right? So once the cork is out. So it gets rid of the love of dunya that you have, so you can give up more and more and more. And the example we can understand is something that's already moving, and it's easier to continue its motion or to increase its motion. But once something is standing, it's difficult to begin its motion. It requires a greater force, right? So if something's already moving, so this is just to get the ball rolling. So guys, just to get the ball rolling. And also it highlights the importance of sadaqah. Mentioning zakat separately and all those categories of people separately tells us that there are two different things. Sadaqah is separate and zakat is separate. And the Messenger said that in your wealth there is a right other than zakat. There's a right other than zakat. Zakat is obligatory. The Muslim state is supposed to forcefully take it away from you if you're not willing to give it. It can do that. It has the right to do it. But sadaqah is more of a moral value. That's something you're supposed to do, but you're not going to be punished for in the dunya. Now you can't have any hajj placed on you anyway, right? But you have to still do it. That's also a obligatory in that sense. Right? The Messenger of Allah said, there is a right in your wealth other than zakat as well. And then he recited this ayah. Then he recited the ayah perfectly, which perfectly delineates the two. Sadaqah is separate and zakat is separate. Right. So moving on. Panacea of all our societal problems. A solution for all the societal problems that we face. وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا عَاهَدُوا. People who fulfill their promises, their contracts, if and when they get into one. Right? If and when they promise, if and when they get into a contract, they scrupulously fulfill those promises. They try their very best to do it as best as they possibly can. That's the implication of وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِعَهْدِهِمْ إِذَا And if you really think about it, all our interpersonal dealings, all the dealings between human beings, no matter at what level, doesn't matter at what level, right? If you're working, if you're in a business, business is based off of contracts, right? So you're supposed to honor your contract. When you get a job, for example, you get a teaching job or you get a job as a doctor, that's based on a contract. The hospital administration is telling you, we will pay you this much for you to work from this hour to this hour, and this is your job description, this is what you're going to do. That's a contract. Now the teacher is supposed to understand that and try to fulfill that contract to the fullest. That the time that he spends in that school, in that classroom, the students need to get what he's getting paid for. He needs to fulfill that contract. The teacher needs to understand the responsibility, needs to understand what he's gotten himself into. That to make that money halal that he will earn at the end of the month, he has to try his very best to give the students the amana that they've given to pay back the trust, to fulfill the trust. The teacher has to give it as well. Whatever the students need, whatever the students want, the teacher has to fulfill it. And same goes for the students. If their parents send them off paying money for them to do a particular degree in a particular way, then they're supposed to do it. They're supposed to do it exactly the way it is into the contract. Right? We pay for you to do, rather than bunking classes, you do what you're sent to. That falls under fulfilling your promise. And then if you look at the societal, at other levels of the society, marriage is a social contract. So both husband and wife need to fulfill their rights and their responsibilities. Right? Give the other person their rights and fulfill their responsibilities. That's a contract. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask about each and every contract and pledge we got ourselves into. Every single thing. And then, at a daily level, when you tell someone 3:30, it's 3:30. No such thing as Pakistani standard time. Right? There's a Muslim standard time. There's a Muslim standard time. And that standard time is this. When you make a promise, when you make a pledge, when you make a contract, similar to those promises. Right. Last, but definitely not. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْحِينَ الْبَأْسِ. Especially above and beyond the patient and person. The word, the way it's usually would have been something was صَابِرُونَ. Because it's not صَابِرُونَ, it's صَابِرِينَ. What that does is that adds to the meaning. The meaning of the word now becomes especially above and beyond. So even though that this is coming at the end of all the other things that we've talked about, this has its own importance. Above and beyond, especially the people who patiently persevere. Sabr, we didn't talk about the last time, this came up in Surah Al-Asr as well. Sabr is to be patient, to be persevering, commitment, to be completely committed, to be constant in whatever you're doing, to be persistent in whatever you're doing. Ibn Taymiyyah said, patience is having, sabr is having the same level of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ease and in difficulty. No matter what the circumstances are, whether they're conducive or not, you have the same level of obedience. Persistence, consistence, that's all embedded in the meaning of sabr. Right? And again, in the context of Surah Al-Asr, if you're doing, the wasif al-haq as such was not mentioned in this ayah, but it's implied. When we go into the details of the situation where sabr is required, then we'll understand how it's implied. The wasif al-haq is automatically implied. So
Sabr will be required. It is not easy for you continuously. The level of iman keeps going up and down. If you continuous with this, in helping other people after peace and difficulty, in being consistent with your salah, being consistent with your zakah, being consistent with your sadaqah, being consistent with keeping your promises at all times, you get mood swings. Right? Your level of iman goes up and down. Everything is happening. Still, you're required to change. You're required to continue doing things the way you were doing it in times of peace. That's patience. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights three times in which we need to be patient. In times of poverty, in times when you don't have that much, in times where you may be going hungry, that's baqsa. Even in those times, you don't have an excuse to think, oh, I don't have anything, so I can't be Muslim anymore. Even in those times, you have to be scrupulous. You have to be still, you still need to maintain that level of taqwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that level of ibadah, that level of serving humanity. That should still be there, right? And no matter what tortures you have to go through, dara is from dara, instead of just removing some harm, some physical or mental harm other people give you, regardless of that. You can't say that they're not listening to me. You can't say that they yelled at me. You can't say that, because whatever we go through, it's not even a fraction of what the messenger and his companions had to go through. They had to face the worst, the most unimaginable kinds of torture, and they yelled strong. That's patience. The companions of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were laid bare on the desert sand, on burning pieces of rock asked by down on them, and the rocks penetrated their backs. Only a means of cooling down the rocks was the flesh of the Sahaba. And they were patient in those circumstances. Bilal was saying, Ahad, he's being whipped on the desert sand. He's being whipped, that's patience. Sumayya radiallahu ta'ala anha is being stripped in front of her son, and whipped and hit by Abu Jahl. And she's presented in title, and he says, at least say there's something in this title. And she spits on it. She does not let go of her iman. That's patience. He takes a spear and he hurls it to the roof. He ties her husband up. He takes four animals, four horses, four camels, and he ties each limb with each animal. Makes them run in four opposite directions. Imagine what happened. His son is now standing there. The son sees this happen to his mother, he sees this happen to his father. That's patience. That's Allah. Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had to go through the worst. What happened at Taif? What happened at Uhud? And his son passed away, his uncle, his neighbor, celebrating out in the streets. He had to patiently persevere through that. He had to maintain, help the orphan, the needy, the poor, the questioner in those circumstances, and he did. That's patience. That's persevering. That's perseverance. No excuses, no complaints. And in the midst of the battle. Because when you adopt this methodology, when you adopt this attitude of piety, then people will not like it. Then people will not like it. They will challenge you. It's inevitable. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sweetest and softest of people, was challenged. He was challenged. If it was possible for him to do it without getting hurt or hurting other people, he would have done it. It wasn't possible. In the midst of the battlefield, it comes to him. You have to show his perseverance. Which is why if there's a salah prescribed even in the middle of the battlefield, even in the middle of the battlefield, the time for prayer comes, then you pray. That's perseverance. Right. Now, if you have all these qualities, if you have all that was mentioned in this one ayah, if you got all of that, then these are the people who are sadaqu. They fell true to their claim of iman. They fell true. We say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, meaning
once, right? We have our entire lives to prove true to that claim. And these are the people who are true to that claim. Who do all of us? Who do all of that? Right? Has been mentioned. As we have the mention of Kulai, we are being told those are distant from us. Those are the people who are so true to their claim of La ilaha illallah. You want to say La ilaha illallah alone is enough to get us into Jannah? And if it's that La ilaha illallah, these people who felt true to it as well. Wa ulaika humul. SubhanAllah, there's such an exclusivity in this ayah. It sort of bars us and forbids us from calling anyone who doesn't have these names. First, everyone follows. Just one ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bursts all our bubbles. Everyone in their own mind thinks that whatever I'm doing, that's righteous. That's neki. That's good. I'm good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this is good. You want a concept of piety from me? This is what it is. You want to be good? This is how good you need to be. So these are the people who are truly conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's true love. So Rabbi Hanna Sahih al-Fa'ali. ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات
ربي الله اكبر.